So at a high level, what we're trying to do is pretty simple. We're trying to get from point A to point B. So you have, you've recently loaded up your haul truck, or you've recently dropped off, and now you need to go to the counterpart destination. And as you can see in a scene like this, you know, that path might not be simple. It's not a straight line. So where do we start? What subsystems and tasks do we need? That might be the best way to start breaking this problem down. So in the reference application that we constructed, we broke this down into four pieces. The first thing we wanted to do is we wanted to determine what was safe versus dangerous terrain and to classify this so that downstream planners could use this to safely navigate from point A to point B. Once we had this representation, we needed to develop planners to actually find those feasible paths between those two points. And then we needed to create controllers for following the path both safely by avoiding obstacles and by taking into account the kinematics of the vehicle. And lastly, a framework for tying it all together. So we'll start with the terrain classification. In a lot of autonomous applications, you have road networks where they largely dictate where you can or can't go. When you are using Google Maps to get from point A to point B, you're using roads that, you know, exist. You're not really going off-road. The challenge when going to these off-road terrains is that you don't necessarily have those road networks, although they may exist. So what we wanted to do is first start with point cloud data taken from USGS, United States Geological Survey. So we have, raw point cloud data that's basically generated by aerial LiDAR. We can stitch it together. And then from there, we want to extract or we want to infer information from this raw format. So what we do is we first convert that point cloud to an elevation map. From there, we can use a gradient and a threshold to determine what is too steep to traverse. And by doing this, you can see the beginnings of a road network start to emerge. Once done, we do some morphological operations on this binary mask to basically clean up the image and further solidify those boundaries of safe versus dangerous. And then from there, some additional morphological operations help us to identify basically the endpoints or branch points within this network or within this space. So basically, we shrink that free space image down to a bunch of line segments. And now this is starting to look much more like something you might see out of Google Maps. Lastly, we run an algorithm with it, which extracts the edges from this image. So now we have a big set of edges or a big set of roads in our space. The next part is we need to find a way to actually use that information to go from point A to point B. And so we will focus now on the planners. One difficulty that you may encounter when you start working in, autonomous motion planning is that there's quite a few options. There's quite a few ways to tackle this problem. So where do you start? One thing that we can do is we can look at the dock. So on the Navigation Toolbox's dock, we have a table that sort of highlights the differences between multiple planners that we ship that break down the type of search, what it's good for, how you can customize it, and plenty more information. So this is a good place to get started. So when it comes to our problem, what are our requirements? You know, if we had our ideal planner, what would it be, or what would make it ideal? You know, we might want it to be performant. We might want it to take into account the kinematics of our vehicle. It might want to need to be optimal, or maybe it doesn't need to be optimal. And then, you know, is this planner supposed to operate on global, a global problem, or is this just a local? Why don't we propose here three separate planners and take a look at how they operate? So if we look at planner A-star, you know, in terms of performance, it's very fast. These are graph-based planners. They're basically looking through a predefined set of edges. So it's very quick, very lightweight. It doesn't take into account the kinematics of your vehicle, And you could say that it's optimal. It's optimal within the graph that you feed it, but it's not optimal in the sense of an MPC planner or an optimization problem that maybe you're familiar with. Planner Hybrid A-Star falls into the search-based planning category. It's basically using pre-canned motion primitives to explore a space. If you compare the performance isn't going to be as good, but it does adhere to the kinematics of a vehicle. Again, it's not necessarily an optimization planner. It will be optimal on the set of primitives that are generated, and typically that's good enough. And then lastly, we have controller TB, which is fast. It respects the kinematics of your vehicle, and it's a true optimization-based planner. If we go back to the global versus local distinction, we see that the Planner A-Star and Planner Hybrid A-Star are global planners. They don't need to be initialized with a guess, and they're really meant for giving you a high-level route between two points. Whereas controller TB needs a reference path, and it's really only trying to find the best solution along that reference path within the vicinity of the vehicle. That brings you to the question of which one is best, right? And the answer is all. You use each one where it fits. So in our navigation stack, what we decided on is we have an efficient high-level planner, which is our road network planner. Or this result basically is appended with a terrain-aware on-ramp planner for getting onto and off of that road network, since the road network it doesn't cover everything. And then we have a robust local planner, which essentially will loop between generating a local reference path along the global reference path, and then following that reference path with a fast MPC-based controller. And then lastly, once we reach the end of our road network route, we use our terrain-aware planner to plan a path between the endpoint of our road network and the desired true destination. So here we can see our graph-based route planner. Again, you can see sort of the sparse nature of the graph within our space. But the goal here is to basically just provide a very fast initial route for going from point A to point B. Here you can see the mouse is, the start location, and we're trying to navigate all the way to the bottom of the mine. As we need to get onto that path generated by the graph planner, we use our terrain-aware free space planner. Basically, this is Planner Hybrid A-Star, and we have an additional customized cost function can penalize trajectories that go along steep terrain. And we use that to guide the path and give a more optimal solution. So now we have our global path, but we need to be able to follow it. So that brings us to our local planner and controller. So our local planner is responsible for creating an optimal path in the local vicinity of the vehicle. And then we're going to follow that path using a nonlinear MPC controller. In the video above, you can basically see how we have a fairly jagged reference path, which is coming from our global planner. And then the controller TB is providing a smooth reference path in the vicinity for MPC to generate control signals along. And MPC here is used to actually ensure we get a smooth path, and also to minimize any drift that we may pick up due to the real world interaction of our vehicle with terrain. So now we have all the different pieces of our navigation stack. We need a way to integrate them together. So in the reference application, if you open up the last example, this will open a Simulink model where we essentially have broken or separated our different planning pieces into subsystems. Lastly, we integrate everything using Simulink and Stateflow. We use this chart to transition between all of the different states. In the latest release, we also added support for Unreal. So here we'll see a demo where we change the simulation mode to Unreal. This launches our open pit mine scene, which is using all of the navigation stack elements that we described earlier to plan a path. So in the top or on the left-hand side, we can see basically a signed distance map of the region surrounding the vehicle. The farther you get away from obstacles, the larger that distance value. And you can see how controller TB essentially repulses the vehicle away from local obstacles, while also generating a path that adheres to the non-holonomic constraints of our vehicle. From there, the path that's generated is followed using the MPC controller, and the vehicle commands are being sent to an agent in Unreal, which uses them to update the vehicle using Unreal's actual physics. And then lastly, we retrieve the current pose of that vehicle and feed it back into our planning stack to close the loop.